Ladies and gentlemen, John Taylor.
In the late 70s here in Britain, every week there was a new band that was breaking out. You know, the charts were not getting clogged up with X Factor and, you know, these idol shows. There was a constant stream of really interesting and cool new music. And the way we saw it, we were students of it, Nick and I, Andy, we all were. And we watched it. We watched it as teenagers. And we didn't think it was, it seemed perfectly doable. It wasn't like, wow, one day we're going to get, you know, you sort of set your first target and you say, I'm going to get on the stage of this club here. And, you know, we're going to do this. And then 6 months later, we're going to get on the stage at that club. And then maybe we'll make it to the Odeon, you know. And how do you get there? Well, you write songs, you know, and you work on your act. We worked so hard. You know, that's really what struck me, was how much work we did. I think 1982, well, 81, which was the year the first album came out, we did 3 British tours. And we went to America for the first time. And we wrote half of the songs for the next album. And it's quite good when you read that, because it takes away that sense of, oh, you guys are so lucky. We just worked really freaking hard. And we were very driven. We never took our foot off the accelerator pedal. And it was good to put it all in order. Yeah. And then when the wheels fell off the bus, I thought, yeah, well, yeah, it was about time. You know, you just can't sustain that kind of momentum for, you know, I mean, sort of 4 or 5 years, I think it was.
I love this idea of you raiding BHS's women's department for suits. Apparently they did a really good line in 40s and 50s suits. And then chiffon animal print blouses. Yeah, Bring it on.
Well, the British Home Stores was like, it was a floor the size of this room, and it was just filled with those sort of, really the kind of suits that your granny would have worn or your Auntie Elsie would have worn, you know, pastel shades. But actually, I mean, for about 6 months back there, you could make those jackets work. This is the kind of lectern Gary Newman would approve of. Want to take it home? Nick would like this. Okay, I'm going to read something. We were getting ahead of ourselves a little bit, but I want to read something about my relationship with my mother and where that led me most days. And this is the first real chapter in the book, and it's called Hey Jude. And this is me here. I know, heartbreaking. How he is going to get messed up, it's just not even funny.
So how did Mr. Le Bon arrive?
Yes, with great elegance, you know, as he does, always. I remember being late. I was late the first time he was there. The first time he showed up, I got there late. I remember talking to him in the restaurant. I mean, I definitely was struck by his presence. He's a tall guy, he's got a great look, and I think, you know, he had that home counties thing going for him. Because I didn't speak like this then, you know, I spoke a little bit more like, I had a bit more of a Birmingham accent, and we all did. And, you know, and Simon came up, and he was just fresh out of, he'd just been doing a fellow that afternoon or something, and he just came in like, "Where for art thou, Bam?" You know, he was just like, you know, he's a guy's a stud, you know. And actually, when a break comes, you should want that break. But I found out I didn't ever want a break.
You didn't want a break from work?
No. I mean, if you know, it'd be like, oh, John, you don't have anything to do today. I'd be like, what do you mean I don't have anything to do today? You've got to find me something to do today. Once I was in that gear, you know, I don't think I slept from, like, January 1981 to Live Aid. I mean, it was, it's just very addictive. The lifestyle was very, very addictive. And I think that I was different from the other guys. I really did not have the off switch. You know, even if bedtime was 5 a.m. and everybody would be like, look, we've got a gig tomorrow, we've got to do a TV show, you know, I'd be the one saying, no, I don't want to go to bed. You know, I'm still up and going. And then that brings with it a whole bunch of, you know, problems, because you're the one with the hangover every day, and you're the one thinking, oh no, did I do that last night? You know, you do that over a period of time, and then it starts weighing down on you. Yeah. And so then you start feeling bad about yourself.
Yeah.
Even though I had a girlfriend back home, my horror of lonely hotel rooms meant I would go to any lengths to avoid sleeping in them alone. Coke, I was beginning to realize, was an effective insurance policy against that eventuality. I'd been a nerd at school. You pointed that out, thank you. I wasn't a jock or an intellectual and had never had a regular girlfriend as a teenager. Now I only had to wink in a girl's direction in a hotel lobby, backstage, or at a record company party, and I had company until the morning. So what's the problem, you might ask? Well, the trouble is, and I didn't figure this out until I was almost 40, that there's something about an intimate encounter of that nature with someone you barely know that jars against the spirit. You want it, but it doesn't feel quite right. And when you start doing it night after night, week in, week out, your ideas about love and sex begin to get somewhat distorted. And jumping into bed like porn star Johnny is not as easy as you might imagine, especially with someone whose first name you're not even sure of. You feel awkward, or at least I did. Maybe it was some residue of Catholic guilt, plain old common decency. Hadn't Mother taught me something about this? The drugs and the alcohol served to take away all those doubts, plus any inhibitions or insecurities I or she might have. I didn't want to be lonely, and the drugs ensured I never was. I'm a pinup on thousands of bedroom walls, but the fear of loneliness is turning me into a cokehead. I didn't, you know, one of the reasons why I didn't really have a relationship, you know, was because I felt I needed to make, you know, I needed to keep myself available. Because, you know, it was this kind of unspoken agreement that I had with the fans that was like, right. No, I'll stay available. You know, Simon's married, Andy's married, Roger's married, but you can rely on me. I'm there, I'm still there for you.
That's a
big A on my head. But it gets lonely after a while, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, I was just miserable. I was just so miserable. I was consumed with guilt and shame, and I was sort of being held together by therapists. And I mean, it was so crazy. I mean, I left Los Angeles to come and work with the guys in London, and I'd said to the therapist in Los Angeles, "You need to find me somebody that I can see when I get off the plane." You know, so when I get off the plane, I go to see a psychotherapist who can like straighten me out, sort me out, so that, you know, within a few days I can actually go and do some work. And I went to see somebody who sent me across town to see somebody else. I spoke to this lady for 15 minutes and she said, whoa, wait a minute, slow down. She says, you need to get sober, because if you get sober, you could really be somebody.
Drugs and the alcohol to turn to. What do you do now to get through bad moments?
Well, there's a lot of. I eat, basically.
Definitely eat.
There's a lot of things. I mean, I talk about them in the book. I mean, you know, I think you have to, you know, we all kind of have to get into the gym. We've got to do. I think as you get older, you've got to work harder, actually, to stay fit. When you're in your 20s, it's like you can eat anything, do anything, and then as you get older, you know, your metabolism starts to slow down. I mean, I've got a program that I was introduced to in rehab, and I stick to it pretty religiously. It's almost like a religion for me, but it's also like a sort of, it's like a self-help code, and, you know, and it's available to all of us. Oh yeah, very much so. Yeah, because I understand why people want to drink and take drugs. I totally get it. I totally understand why by the time most people have finished work, either on Monday or Friday, they're ready for a drink.
Yeah.
I totally get that. You know, and when you can't do that, you know, then you've got to find another way of decompressing.
It's more of a confession than anything else. You spoke about fans camping outside your house. Newport train station in South Wales to Victoria and a camp outside Ennismore Mews.
Right, that's it.
And I nicked your doormat.
You know, I'm not one to hold grudges. But that doormat was very special.
I've still got it in the middle of the attic.
Did you, during your time, ever get to hear demo tapes of up-and-coming bands, any bands you'd never heard of?
Not a lot of, no.
Because I was convinced, I'm a bass player myself, and I've got a reasonable career as well.
I can see where this is going.
I was convinced Sin of the City off the Weston album was stolen from one of my... from demo tapes that I've been sending out. Because there was a song that I played on for somebody, and it was note for note the same. And I was convinced he'd ripped my bass line off.
Yes.
Checks in the post.
Trying to think of a wise crack, and I can honestly say I don't think that was the case. But
I don't honestly believe it, really.
Yeah.
It was just coincidence.
Yeah. Well, are you still playing bass?
Still play, yeah.
Well, send me some tapes, really. I need a little inspiration for the next album.
Ladies and gentlemen, magnetic John Taylor.